All right, welcome to First Baptist Church. I'm glad you all came to join us this morning. If you would, please join me in standing. We'll begin our service by singing, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less." Singing of the word and also the preaching of the word. Lord, I pray that you change us during this hour. Lord, I pray that that change would not just stop after this morning worship service. I pray that we would desire true heart change to be more like Jesus throughout the entire week. Lord, I thank you so much for how you do love us and how you do care for us. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. If you would take a moment and greet the people around you.
You might get their attention enough to receive those, and if you could just fill out the card sometime today and return it to us, either in the offering plate or after the service. We've got a guest hospitality center over here. We'd love to meet you. You can give us the card there and give you a gift in exchange. Just to say thanks for being with us here today. We have a few announcements as we begin. First of all, you may have noticed Pastor Pete is not here today. He and his family are on vacation enjoying spring break, so let's be in prayer for them as they travel back. They've been gone this entire past week. This morning we began some new GROW seminars in our Sunday school hour, so if you have not had a chance to take a look at the list of seminars available to you, you can see that we have them listed in the bulletin again this week. It'll be the last week they're in the bulletin, so find a seminar. I'd encourage you, just find one and plug yourself in for the next, 12 weeks after this. You will find that it is profitable for your soul. So I encourage you now, find one even at this moment and dedicate yourself to being a part of that for the next several weeks. Today, the Easter flower forms are due. If you'd like to order some tulips or lilies for $7.50, go ahead and put your money over there and sign up for that. The orders are due today for that. And then I just want to let you know what's going on this afternoon. First of all, for serve night, because it's serve night, there won't be any serve training in this building tonight. There will still be a one at 5:30, but there won't be student ministries or serve training. Instead, the Primrose Church service will be going on at the Primrose Community Home at 2:30 p.m. You can go ahead and meet there if you're interested in being a part of it. I know it says 2 p.m. in the bulletin. That used to be when we meet here. But go ahead and just meet at Primrose at 2:30 if you'd like to be a part of it. It's not just for teenagers to go minister. This is anybody who'd like to go minister to the residents there. It'll be at 2:30 p.m. at Primrose. Also, at 3 o'clock, Steve Pachesny is going to be heading up a bit of a cleanup day outside. Thankfully, the weather is warming up a little bit. We want to make sure that our grounds and the outside of the building are looking as good as we can get them to look here before Easter coming up in just a few weeks. So if you could come at 3 p.m., or even if you can't be there right at 3, they'll be working until 5 p.m., go ahead and bring your own tools, or if you want to bring some gloves or some rakes. We just want to clean up the lawns a little bit, clean out some of the flower beds, pick up some trash, things like that. If you can bring some stuff to help, or if you're not sure what stuff might be helpful, go ahead and talk to Steve Pachesny after the service. He'd be happy to help you see what might be helpful that you bring tonight. We are going to take our offering now, so if the ushers would come forward now, let's go ahead and pray as we receive the morning offering. Father, you have been so gracious to us in giving to us your word, in giving to us salvation through Jesus' name. You have given to us everything that we need and so much more. And as you have blessed us financially, I do pray that you would give us the grace to be able to give back to you abundantly, generously, as you call us to in your word. So I pray now that as we receive this offering, that you would be glorified through the giving of your people, to support the ministries of this church, to see your gospel spread both here in Mishawaka and around the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Psalm chapter 62:8 says this: trust him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Right now we're going to sing Refuge of My Weary Soul.
Scripture reading this morning, if you would, read the italicized verses. Blessed is
the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him.
Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one.
But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire.
Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death.
Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change.
Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be the kind of first fruits of his creatures.
Join with me right now. Let's sing of the faithfulness of our God. Great is thy faithfulness. Father, we praise you for everything that you are, everything good, perfect about you, Lord, we can trust in. And I thank you for giving us your message, the Bible. Lord, I thank you so much that we have the church where we are able to gather together, sing praises to you, and even though we may not always feel like it, Lord, we do need to sing praises to you and to hear the word preached and to be here for each other and encourage each other and build each other up. Lord, we need you to change us. We cannot change on our own. We need your Holy Spirit to come into our lives and to change us to be more like our Savior, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, that is what I ask right now, Lord, is that you would be Lord of our life in every area, and not just the areas on the that are easy to give. Lord, I pray that you would be Lord of our life even on the tough days, where it's hard to praise your name, where it's hard to see your goodness and your faithfulness. Lord, that's why we come here, is to be encouraged by the word, be edified by the word of God. And even as we sing truths of who you are, Lord, I pray that you would change us. Lord, don't let us be still, be stagnant in our growth. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. If you're able to, please stand with us one last time. This is one of my personally favorite songs, Great One in Three. Sing with me. Come now, Almighty King.
Embracing us before all trials.
dismissed at this time will be remaining in the service.
I'll be reading from Scripture, 1 Kings chapter 17 this morning. If you'd like to follow along, I'll be 1 Kings 17, verses 17 through 24. Follow along with me while I read, if you would. After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill. And his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. And she said to Elijah, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." And he said to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged and laid him on his own bed. And he cried to the Lord, "O Lord my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?" Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried to the Lord, "O Lord my God, let this child's life come into him again." And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. And the life of the child came into him again, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house and delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." And the woman said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is true."
What happens when God has been blessing your life and you are experiencing spiritual progress that you have never experienced before? But then suddenly, during a routine checkup at the doctor's office, the doctor notices something irregular, and after a few more tests, he tells you that you have cancer. What happens when you decide to yield your finances to God and you begin to give generously to the Lord's work and He decides to bless you and He gives you larger income? And then, out of the blue, your only working car dies. And then your furnace goes out in the middle of the winter. And then you lose the job to which God has been blessing you financially. What happens when God has been blessing abundantly and then the bottom drops out? What now, God? If you were to consider this question long enough, you would probably admit that you have wondered about it before in your life, maybe several times. It's this very type of question that the narrative of Elijah addresses in 1 Kings 17. 17 to 24, our text this morning. If you haven't turned there already, please turn there with me now. If we were to look back in chapter 16, we would see that Ahab becomes king in Israel. Now, if you remember your history from the Old Testament, you may remember that the kingdom of Israel, after the reign of Solomon, splits into two different kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. The southern kingdom of Judah had a few good kings. But if you'll remember, the kings of the northern kingdom, well, they seem to just be doing their absolute best to outdo one another in who could be the most wicked king imaginable. Verse 30 of chapter 16 says this, "And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord, more than all who were before him." You see, Ahab married Jezebel, who's the daughter of the Sidonian king, and they worshipped Baal, the Canaanite god of rain and fertility. Jezebel was so determined that everybody in Israel was going to worship Baal that she convinced her husband to build a temple to Baal in Israel. Baal was a prominent god of the Canaanites because he supposedly controlled the rain, which was essential to an agricultural society. They depended on rain for their crops. And at the beginning of chapter 17, God sends Elijah, his faithful prophet, to Ahab to announce his judgment on the nation by withholding rain, thus displaying his power over Baal. Well, after this, God promises in verse 3 to protect Elijah from Ahab and sustain him at the brook Kerith, which he does by allowing him to drink from the brook and by miraculously sending ravens to send him food. Well, God is off to a great start in showing his mighty hand in how he can protect and sustain Elijah. But the problem is, the brook eventually does dry up, and it's unable to quench Elijah's thirst. So God promises again to provide for Elijah, and he tells him in verse 9 that he would send him to a widow's house in Zarephath, a place in Sidon, that's Jezebel's hometown, and the heart of Baal territory. Now this presents a seemingly more difficult challenge for Jehovah. Well, sure, he can provide for Elijah in his own territory, but can he provide for Elijah in Baal country? In perhaps a more impressive way, God provides for him there by supernaturally extending the widow's supply of flour and oil until the conclusion of the drought. Elijah obeys God immediately in both circumstances, and God fulfills his promise to provide for him abundantly. Things are looking good for Elijah, and God has shown his power, both at home and in enemy territory. And that's where we pick up the story today. And as we go through this passage, we're going to see trial, trust, and triumph. These three hooks to help us hang all of the three parts of the story: trial, trust, and triumph. Let's take a look at verse 17 to see what God's next plans are for Elijah and the widow after his faithful provision in the previous verses. It says in verse 17, "After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill, and his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him." Wow. That's not what we expected to hear. I mean, God has been miraculously providing for Elijah through some incredible means. While obeying God's command, Elijah has been led to a brook where he has been supernaturally fed by ravens. Folks, Amazon is beginning to deliver packages by drones today. But what we're seeing here is about 3,000 years ahead of its time. And when God is done providing through that means, he leads Elijah to Zarephath in the heart of Baal territory, where he is unexplainably fed by a widow's endless supply of food from a jar. Now, folks, today we have bottomless fries at Red Robin. But again, this is 3,000 years ago. Elijah actually experienced the original bottomless fries at the widow's house. They never ran out. God was clearly blessing Elijah in unique ways. But then, something unexpected happened. In the midst of great blessing, when everything was going smoothly according to the word of the Lord, the widow's son dies. What is going on? This doesn't seem to fit with the flow of the story. God promised by his word that he would lead and he would protect and he would provide, and he's been doing just that in some pretty remarkable ways. But here it looks like God really dropped the ball. In fact, there appears to be a very stark difference between Elijah's first experience in Zarephath in verses 8 to 16 and his experience in verses 17 to 24, our text this morning. to modernize and to personalize verses 8 to 16, where the Lord provides for Elijah and the widow, think of it this way. You prayed for God to sustain you in hard times, and he gives you a raise. You ask God to bring a godly man or woman into your life, and you get married. You beg God to display his power to your unsaved neighbor by healing you of your cancer. And after months of praying, when the results come back in, you're given a clean bill of health. That's Elijah's experience with the bottomless fries, folks. Times got tough, he prayed, and God straightened things out. But now the widow's son, for whom God had promised to provide, has died. Now the bottom drops out. And if we want to modernize verses 17 to 24 and personalize them, think of it this way. After receiving that raise, you get laid off. After finding that spouse in a couple of seemingly happy years of marriage, your spouse wants a divorce. After being declared cancer-free, after months of praying, the doctors call you later to say that it was a mistake, and the cancer has actually spread, and you won't live much longer. What now, God? It looked like you had things under control. You put out the fire in the burning building, but now the entire structure has collapsed. How should we respond to your apparent fickle behavior in our lives? Perhaps these are some of the questions that we ask when we're faced with similar circumstances, when we go through a trial. Maybe you're here this morning and you have a trial of your own. Possibly it's something that nobody else in this room knows about. As we've seen in Elijah's life, deep trials often follow peaks of triumph. Things are going well. Maybe you've embraced the vision of the church this year and you're starting to grow spiritually by reading your Bible regularly for the first time. Or maybe you've started having a time of family worship together and God is revealing himself to you in ways he never has before in the Word of God like you've never noticed before. Or maybe you begin pouring yourself into your brothers and sisters in Christ in your growth group. And you see God using your gifts to build up his church one life at a time like you've never witnessed before. We naturally expect that things will just get better and better and better, but often these high points in our life are followed by deep valleys of trial. And we wonder if God knows what he's doing. After looking at Elijah's situation, we wonder, what is going on? Has God lost his ability to sustain life in the homeland of Baalism? Why would God allow this to happen to the woman who had spared Elijah from death? Hospitality to the man of God should have brought blessing on the widow's house, right? And the clearest form that blessing could take was immunity from the natural disasters of life, right? Does God know what he's doing? What was the poor widow to think as she watched her child die in this house that had seemed to be so uniquely blessed by God? How was she to interpret these two signs, the everlasting barrel of food and then the sudden and tragic death of her son? Well, as we read the widow's response in verse 18, look for her explanation to the death of her son. And she said to Elijah, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." So in her grief, whom specifically does the widow blame? Elijah. Isn't that incredible? Just a few verses earlier, they were living it up, eating the bottomless fries together, while everybody else was starving because of the drought. And now the widow is basically saying that it would have been better if Elijah had never come. She seems to have forgotten that if Elijah had never come, she and her son would both be dead. It was common in those days, even as it is today, to believe that sin and suffering have a direct cause and effect relationship. We see that in Job's friends as they accuse him of hidden sin when he experienced intense suffering. And also when Jesus' disciples asked the Lord whose sin was responsible for the man being born blind. Is God punishing the widow here for some sin of which we have no knowledge? Well, we don't have to go far into this widow's history to see why she is so upset at the loss of her son. I mean, although she's already been deprived of her husband, she at least now has a son who, as she ages, can care for her and take care of her, and even more importantly, who can live on with the family name, survive her late husband's family name. The death of her son meant that her marriage, indeed her life itself, had all gone for nothing. Such disaster, she reasons, can only be attributed to God punishing grave but unrecognized sin. She doesn't trust, she blames. And as illustrated in the widow's response here to her trial, when we fail to trust God, we often resort to anger and blame, don't we? We point fingers wherever we can. We lash out at those closest to us or closest to the situation. We become bitter at God for allowing trials. And we seem to forget about his abundant blessings from yesterday. What do you think? When God personalizes verses 17 to 24 in our lives, how do we respond? Do we blame those who have previously been a tremendous blessing in our lives, like the widow did? Do we blame the church or other believers for the problems that we face? Or do we just assume that we must have sinned somewhere along the way and God is now punishing us by sending hardships in our lives? When I was growing up, I had a very deficient view of God and his working in my life. I can remember as a young child, several times when I was sick or something bad would happen to me, I would barter with God in my prayers. Maybe some of you have done something like that. God, if you'll just make me feel better, I will pay better attention in church. Right? We had these ceiling fans in our auditorium at church. And during the summertime, they turn them on to kind of cool us off. And I had this strange practice to try to improve my focus. I would try to focus in on one of the blades and watch it go around and around and around. Just kind of slow it down and focus in on it. It was an exercise in focus. What I should have done to improve my focus was trying to understand what my pastor was saying. God, if you'll just make me feel better, I'll pay attention more in church. Or, God, if you will just allow this to happen, I will obey my mom more. And I don't know if it's a poor testament to my resolve to carry my end of the bargain or if God just wasn't interested in bargaining with me, but that never seemed to help. You can ask my mom. Well, let's go back to the story of Elijah. Is this apparent rash killing of the boy something God is doing to judge the widow's sin? Is every suffering or disaster someone experiences a direct result of some former sin that they've committed? How will Elijah, the man of God, respond to this widow's critical accusation and God's apparent failure to provide for them? Will Elijah blame God for failing to keep his word after previously blessing his obedience? Well, as we observe how Elijah responds to the widow in verses 19 to 21, take note of how much knowledge Elijah has concerning what God is doing in this tragedy. And he said to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged and laid him on his own bed. And he cried to the Lord, "O Lord, my God, why have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?" Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried to the Lord, "O Lord, my God, Let this child's life come into him again. So how does Elijah respond to the widow's attack of his character as a man of God? He calmly takes the boy from her arms, brings him upstairs, and sets him on the bed. He doesn't try to give an answer to the widow or explain exactly what God is doing in her time of grief. He doesn't try to defend his own honor, which he has clearly attacked. He just takes the boy upstairs. Also, and this is important for us to understand the tension of the story and key to understanding the purpose for why God included this story, did you notice that Elijah knew exactly what God was doing by killing the child? No, absolutely not. He cries out to God and expresses his complete lack of understanding of God's dealings with him and the widow. Elijah himself clearly has no idea why this tragedy is struck. He doesn't know what God is doing. But what does Elijah do next? Does he curse God for letting him down and failing to provide when he had clearly promised that he would? What does Elijah do? The text that we just read says that Elijah expressed his lack of understanding and then asked God to show his power by providing in the midst of a dire situation. Elijah stretches his body over the child 3 times and pours out his soul before God, expressing his complete dependence on him. Folks, when we trust God, we still don't have all the answers. We still don't know what's going on. When we're in the middle of the forest of our trials, we only see the trees. We don't have God's perspective. And God doesn't expect us to know everything, but he does expect us to trust him. So how do we respond to circumstances when it looks like God has dropped the ball? How do we take criticism from the world when they claim that our God can't provide for us or that he actually doesn't want to provide for us? How do we answer when they say that God can't be a loving God if he allows this to happen in our lives? Do we pray like so many of the psalm writers who effectively say this, God, what are you doing? I don't know, but I trust you. Or do we respond like the widow and become angry, blaming God for failing to care? Elijah has some tough questions to ask himself in this dire situation. After he's laid his faith in God and reputation as a man of God on the line, what will God do? Is he going to leave Elijah hanging? Will he prove Elijah's faith to be silly? Will God continue to fulfill his promise to provide for Elijah and the widow? Or are there times when he capriciously decides he's tired of providing? Is God able to fulfill his word? It's one thing to rescue people from the jaws of death like he did when he provided the endless food. But can he do anything when that death clamps shut its jaws upon a person? Can God act across the border from Israel and Sidon? But is there a border that he can't cross? A kingdom in which he has no power? When faced by death, must the Lord, like Baal, bow the knee? Let's read verse 22 to find out. It says, and the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child came into him again, and he revived. So how does God respond to Elijah when he puts it all on the line by trusting in God? Verses 22 and 23 make it clear that as Elijah continues to trust and obey, even as the trials become more difficult and daunting, God continues to fulfill his promise of provision to Elijah by raising the widow's son from the dead. This is by far the most miraculous of God's provisions on behalf of Elijah, and it is the first recorded resurrection from the dead in the Bible. Trial, trust, and triumph. Not only does God not leave Elijah hanging, he also proves to be superior to Baal in yet another way. I didn't say this earlier, folks, but in the Baal myths, Baal was subject to the laws of nature. You see, every single year, as the god of rain, he died in the dry season. He was subject to nature. But God is not subject to death. He is Lord over it. But what about the widow? How does she respond to this miraculous healing of her son? Let's look at verses 23 and 24. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house and delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." And the woman said to Elijah, Now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth." You see, God revives the widow's son, and she gives us real insight here into why God included this short story in his word. She says that this event has caused her to realize that, number one, Elijah really is a man of God, and number two, God's word really is true. So why didn't she believe before? Why didn't she believe when they were eating the bottomless fries? Why didn't she believe that God's word was true in the midst of great blessing and provision? Well, it's apparent that there is something very unique and special about this final sign of resurrection that God gave during Elijah's stay at Zarephath. And by it, both the widow and Elijah knew that God's word was truth indeed. What is it? What is it that was unique about this incident? Even when it is apparent that God had actually failed to provide, or that he was instead bringing punishment, he was still committed to fulfilling his word. Folks, previously when God promised to provide, times got tough, but God came through. This time, however, not only did times look bleak, it actually appeared that God was either unable to provide, or he was intent on leaving Elijah high and dry. And yet in the end, God still came through on his promise. And folks, we need to learn that if God's word promises us blessing, it gives us blessing indeed. We don't need to be afraid in dealing with God as if there were two sides to him. He's not at one time loving and just, and at another time capricious and spiteful. He does not show himself merciful today towards his people, only to let them find out on the next day that he's had another whim and he's angry with them. He doesn't give his children a stone when he promises bread, and he doesn't give them a snake when he promises fish. In our Christian lives, we are often being subjected to the same kind of trial that Elijah and this woman faced. We are certainly surrounded by innumerable signs of God's mercy to us each and every day. But suddenly, when we're faced with a seemingly insurmountable trial, do we forget God's blessing and accuse him of not fulfilling his promises to us like the widow did? Have you ever received a promotion at work only to lose your job a short while later? Was God just acting capriciously or knocking you around like a young boy does for pleasure with ants in an ant farm? No. He keeps his word even through the most hopeless and difficult circumstances. What will you do if people attack your integrity or blame you for failures in their lives? Will you turn to God and lay your reputation on the line by trusting him completely to fulfill his word? Or will you bemoan your condition and claim that God must not be powerful enough to fulfill his word in a world where evil seems so powerful? Now, we need to make a few things clear at this point, because it would be easy for us to walk away with a surface level understanding of this text and then apply it poorly. First of all, although in this situation God provided for Elijah by raising the widow's son, This doesn't mean that God always eventually does what we want him to do. Right? In fact, God doesn't always bring about our desired outcome in a trial. The point of this passage is to show that God always fulfills his promises. He always keeps his word. God had promised to provide for Elijah, and in this case, that meant raising the widow's son. But that doesn't mean that every time we get sick, God gives us physical healing. It doesn't mean that when we lose our job, we always get one that pays us better. What we want in our trials is not always what God wants for us. Instead, God does bring about his own glory through the trial. That might mean that he shows his power by healing us. But it might mean that he gives us the strength to bear up under the weight of the trial, so that people see us and recognize that only God could give us such endurance in a trial. Our former senior pastor, David Miller, is an example of this. Here's a man who God used in so many different ways to accomplish his will for his own glory. But in a time that seemed like out of nowhere, God allowed him to experience a disease that slowly drained him until he faded from this world just a few weeks ago. This is not the result that so many people who loved and cared about him prayed for or desired. This is not what I prayed for and desired for him when I originally heard what he was going through. And yet, through Pastor Miller's testimony, many, many people observed him and his resolution to trust God. And that witness resulted in fruit for Christ. We simply don't know what God's plan is, but we know that he is committed to keeping his promises. And that includes bringing himself glory through our trials. Now, maybe you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with God. I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad that you've come to hear from God through his word. This passage in the Old Testament, the first recorded resurrection of the Bible, naturally points us forward to a time in the New Testament where Jesus, God's perfect Son, died on the cross to pay the penalty for sins that he never committed. He died for our sins so that we wouldn't have to. He died so that if we would have faith in him and place our faith in Jesus alone, we would receive everlasting life. You see, folks, Jesus did not stay dead. God raised Jesus from the dead the third day. In just a few weeks, we'll be celebrating a time of Easter, a time of resurrection, where we celebrate the most glorious act in history, Jesus Christ's resurrection from the dead. Folks, Jesus' resurrection means that for those who place their faith in him alone, turn from their sins and place their faith in Jesus alone, they too will be raised. We too will have everlasting life. And if you're here today and you have never entered into a relationship with God, you can be saved today. Because of what Jesus did for us, we are safe forever from the rightful punishment for our sins. And if you haven't, I invite you now to turn in faith to God and confess that you are a sinner in need of a Savior. Trust in Jesus today to save you from your sins. In this passage, God has proven his complete power over all the forces of this world, and he is fully capable of fulfilling his word. So it's our joyful response as believers to follow Elijah's example and obey God, even when we don't understand why God allows the bottom to drop out. Even when he allows pain and adversity in our lives, and even when it appears that God has failed to keep his promises, we will bring him glory by trusting him. It's in these circumstances that people are proven to be true men and women of God, and when God's word is shown to be truth. An ancient Puritan prayer from the Valley of Vision illustrates this story. Lord, high and holy, meek and lowly. Thou hast brought me to the valley of vision, where I live in the depths, but see thee in the heights. Hemmed in by mountains of sin, I behold thy glory. Let me learn by paradox that the way down is the way up, that to be low is to be high, that the broken heart is the healed heart, that the contrite spirit is the rejoicing spirit, that the repenting soul is the victorious soul, that to have nothing is to possess all, that to bear the crown is to wear the crown, and to give is to receive, that the valley is the place of vision. Lord, in the daytime, stars can be seen from the deepest wells, and the deeper the wells, the brighter thy stars shine. Let me find thy light in my darkness, thy life in my death, thy joy in my sorrow, thy grace in my sin, thy riches in my poverty, thy glory in my valley. Let's pray. Father, we admit to you this morning that we are dependent creatures. And as we face trials, as we most certainly will and do, and maybe right now, that we do not see the end from the beginning. But we trust in a sovereign God who knows the end from the beginning, because you are both in the beginning and the end. You are eternal. Oh God, would you give us the grace to trust in you when we don't see what you're doing? We don't understand what it is you're doing in our lives. Give us the faith to believe that you're doing it to bring yourself glory. And may we rejoice in the possibility, the opportunity to take part as a tool for your glory. That the nations would see us in our suffering and see the strength that only a sovereign and powerful God could provide. That they would see and fear and trust in you. Father, would you be glorified through our valleys, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you would join me in standing, together we're going to sing Rock of Ages. Sing with me two verses of Rock of Ages.
Sacred ceremony that we partake in as a church. If you're here and you are a believer in Jesus Christ, we invite you to participate with us in the Lord's Supper. Let me please read for you a passage that we often do, that the Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That's what we want to do this morning. We want to proclaim the Lord's death, recognizing that with that death came a resurrection, newness of life. Folks, as we remember what the Lord suffered 2,000 years ago, as his body was given as an offering in our place, let's also remember that he was raised, that he's coming back for us. And every time we do this, we look forward to the time when we will celebrate this together with all the saints in his presence. Gentlemen, you rise, please. Let's pray before we start. Father, we thank you for the bread representing your body, which was given as an offering for us. I pray that as we remember, we would glorify you and the great cost that our salvation required. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Father, for the blood of your Son poured out for us. As we remember, we recognize that his blood shed for us meant him giving his very own life in our behalf. Oh, what a precious cost to purchase our redemption. And I pray now as we rejoice in this, we remember that He has been raised. Jesus is alive today, and he intercedes for us. And now we can go from this place and with joy serve you. So I pray that you would quicken us and make us strong to be obedient servants of Christ, giving our lives dedicated to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This time our deacons are going to rise and collect your cups, and we will close with a word of prayer.
Outside of it, they don't see your purposes at work. Lord, I pray that you would supply for them strength. And I pray that they would hold on to the truths of your word, that you are faithful, that you are just, you are victorious. Lord, we have requests that we bring before you. I think right now of Corbin Nelson, who is right now recovering from a surgery, from an appendectomy. Lord, I pray that he would continue to recover well. But I also think of Jim Hoover. I pray that you would supply him and his family grace as he begins his dialysis process. And Lord, I also want to uplift, Lord, the Wesco family as they're going through a lot of trials right now. And a lot of temptations, I'm sure, will be presented towards them. But I pray that if any way we can encourage them, I pray that we would be uplifting them in prayer, as well as just so many other requests, Lord, that we are just don't have time to mention right now. But Lord, every single time, Lord, we look into your word, I pray that we would uplift those around us, Lord, with our words and with our prayers. Lord, I thank you so much for bringing us here today. I pray that your Holy Spirit would move in our lives and continue to mold us and change us to be more like our Savior, Jesus Christ. As we go into this week, God, I pray that our passion would be for souls, people, that we would see people come to know Jesus Christ, and that we would see ourselves grow and mature to be more like Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for coming, you're dismissed.